السلام عليك زين الأنبياء السلام عليك.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا مولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أجمعين سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. After all of those beautiful words that we just heard, I'm not so sure anything else needs to be said other than Ameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make what we've heard a reality in our lives. And may we be people who that receive the mercy of Allah and then show the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, show the mercy to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's creatures, and thus receive more of His mercy subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the only other thing that I think I would like to contribute tonight is, as human beings, we all have mindsets. And there is this idea, or it's been articulated in the modern world, of this idea of a growth mindset versus a fixed mindset. And there are some very stark differences between the two. And it seems pretty clear that the growth mindset is much closer, as it is defined, to the Sunnah of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And essentially what it is an approach on life and how it is that we view our own circumstances, how it is that we view what happens to us, how it is that we view everything that is transpiring around us. And it's really important for the growth of an individual and the spiritual development of any individual, and by extension the family in the community, is that we all think very carefully about these two different types of mindsets. And there are a number of different traits that are associated with each. But just to highlight a few that I think are really important in this regard, because as we've heard, we are frail as human beings. And we live in an incredibly difficult time. An incredibly difficult time. And the incredibly difficult time that we live in requires even more mercy. And the incredibly dark time that we live in requires that we tap into the reservoirs of more intense light. And even though it's very easy to give up and to become pessimistic, be ready to throw in the towel, to think that there's nothing that you can actually really do, we have to resist all of those temptations, because those are from shaitan. And ultimately, shaitan wants to make us grieve. He wants to make us sad. He wants us to throw in the towel and give up, and to think that there's nothing that we can do. And I've never seen people as optimistic as our teachers. And they learn that from their teachers, who learn that from their teachers, who ultimately learn that from the Prophet himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No one was more optimistic, and I'm going to refrain from adding any adjective before the type of optimism that is being referred to, because ultimately it's prophetic optimism that Allah Ta'ala wanted our Prophet to have, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Of course, there's different types of optimism, and it doesn't mean that we're naive and have that false hopes or anything like that. This is real, true, religious optimism that comes up from a prophetic source. And our teachers exemplify that. And they teach us to also be from those who try to do the same. And even if no one ever even responded to anything that we've ever would try to do, we still have to do it. But that's hard. We tend to be more engaged with something that if there's a response, if there's something that's somewhat self-gratifying in the process. But we're taught to be people of principle regardless, and to do what is right, even if it's bitter, even if it's difficult to do. And this is one of the key features of this growth mindset, is that in the growth mindset, you engage challenges to improve, as opposed to the fixed mindset, which avoids challenges out of fear of failure.
You embrace the challenges. You recognize that there's going to be difficulties. And you take that on. You know there's going to be that challenges ahead of you. You know yourself are going to go through a number of different stages in life. But whereas the fixed mindset might avoid any challenges, and then when they apparently fail outwardly, with the fixed mindset, you're ready to give up. Whereas the gross mindset takes it very differently. You lost in the moment. You seem to have failed outwardly in relation to that particular thing. But if you learned a lesson, it's not really a loss. From the standpoint of reality, it's actually a win. And there might be something that you get from that that you couldn't have gotten otherwise. And Ibn al-Ta'ira indicated this when he said, is that رُبَّ مَعْصِيَةٍ أَوْرَثَتْ ذُلًّا وَانْكِسَارًا. How many an act of disobedience that leads you to be humble and broken before Allah is better than an act of obedience that leads you to arrogance and haughtiness. So you might think you're doing everything's okay, but if you're impressed with yourself, if you think you were the one that's doing it, you might be further veiled, and it might lead you to a greater sin even. But if you fall short, it doesn't mean that you open up the door to intentionally fall short, but if you do, you learn from your lesson. You renew your resolve to repent and to never do it again. And who knows, that might be the last time that you ever do that thing. You might learn something from an outward failure that you need throughout your life. And this is one of the things that we learn from this growth mindset. And with the growth mindset, you approach people very differently. How people treat you, what they say. People with this mindset treat criticism as an opportunity. Criticism as an opportunity. Whereas people with a fixed mindset treat criticism as an attack. They let their ego get in the way. And this is one of the four things that Imam Ghazali says, that how you can come to know how to purify your own soul is by listening to people who criticize you. Because there's always going to be elements of truth in the criticism, even if it's that taken a bit out of context, even if it's a bit exaggerated, there's elements of truth. But none of us like to hear criticism, and especially with people that we live with. And none of us like to hear criticism, especially with people that we might not get along with fully. But with this mindset, it's very different. Criticism is an opportunity for us to grow. It's an opportunity for us to find out things about ourselves that otherwise we might not know. And so the people that have this mindset, for them, obstacles are very different. They strive to persist in overcoming obstacles as opposed to just avoiding them altogether and not being willing to work hard. These are people that want to improve, as opposed to prove who it is they are, what it is that they have. Every opportunity is an opportunity to improve, to learn more, to not fall into the same mistake a second time. And when we learn about these lofty principles, this is how we have to be. Because these principles are so lofty, as we've just heard, we might leave the mawlid and fail to put it into practice. It might take us weeks, it might take us years on end to put some of these things into practice. But it doesn't mean that we could just throw in the towel. We cannot just say, I'm going to give in. And you've only truly lost if you've actually given and you throw in the towel. That's when you really lose. And then as long as you make up for that and change your mindset before you die, then you can cover up the mistakes of the past. And you can never, ever, ever lose hope. Our deen doesn't allow that. No matter what you've done, even if you've done every sin that you could possibly commit, our deen does not allow you to lose hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And our hope is real hope. It's hope in Allah. Our hope is not in people. Our hope is in Allah and in His bounty. And alhamdulillah, He's the one who's going to judge us. And alhamdulillah, He's the one that we have to answer to. if we'd have to answer to even to our close friend, if they really knew everything about us, we'd have troubles. Alhamdulillah, Allah is the one that we have to answer to. And think about all of the blessings of Allah Ta'ala upon us. Everything we heard that Ustadh Yusuf reminded us of all these different connections. That the way that our deen synchronizes us with everything around us. How could we have anything other in our heart than love for our Lord? أَحِبُّ اللَّهَ لِمَا يَغْذُوكُمْ بِهِ مِنْ نِعْمَةٍ. Love Allah for what He provides you of His blessings. Every blessing, Imam al-Ghazali says, is a means for us to draw near to Allah Ta'ala. Every blessing is a door for ma'rifah, to know Allah. And when we start to reflect upon the blessings individually, each one is an individual path that takes us to knowledge of our Creator and draws us near to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we imagine ourselves immersed, completely immersed in blessing, that gratitude that we then show very easily manifests as muhabbah, as love. And then when we move up in degree and we start to realize that Allah deserves to be loved, which is the higher of the two degrees, so that we love Him because He deserves to be loved. Because of His attributes of perfection, His attributes of majesty, and His attributes of beauty, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and all of the reasons that human being loves, it's most perfectly manifested and truly manifested in our love that we have for our Creator, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then when we start to live that meaning, everything at that point starts to change. All the problems are seen differently. And for the lovers, it's very easy to have a growth mindset. For the true lovers, it's very easy to have the growth mindset because these are people that see everything being from Allah. And they know that Allah Ta'ala will only send their way that which is in their own interest in what is good for them. And so it requires iman, of course, but then it also requires these other traits of muhabbah. And if we have this love in our heart for our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, we could very easily respond to our challenges in a way that is very different. And I want to close by just reminding something that we discussed on Tuesday, but it struck me and I wanted to share. Because the context of this was appealing to Allah only for all of our needs. Anything that we go through, first and foremost, we want to take that to Allah. And this is based upon a reality that true existence belongs to Allah alone. And all other existence is contingent existence. It is dependent upon the existence of Allah. So from the perspective that you look at things in and of themselves, they don't truly exist. Except insofar as Allah has given them existence. And so any need that we have, the advice of these people is, whatever that might be, whether it be that straitened circumstances and you're struggling financially, or whether it be health-related, or whether it be that relationship-related, or whatever it might be, whatever you're going through, their advice is, فَأَنزِلْهَا بِاللَّهِ, is that literally, take that need to Allah. وَجْعَلْهُ تَحْتْ مِشِيَةِ اللَّهِ, and make that difficulty that you're going through, that view it as being from the will of Allah. وَغِبْ عَنْهَا فِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ, and literally annihilate yourself in the remembrance of Allah so that you completely forget it. What amazing advice is that? But that is, again, as Ustadh Amjad was teaching us, difficult. Like, look at how precious that is. All of our difficulties that we're going through. You know how it is when you're going through the bitterness of some difficulty. You lost a loved one. You lost your job. You're having health problems. You're sick. Whatever it is going on in your life. And in those moments, sometimes you don't want to do anything. You just want to drown it out by watching a movie or surfing the internet or looking at your social media feeds or something. But if we can start to put that meaning into practice, وَغِبْ عَنْهَا فِي ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ, is that we literally forget it because we're so preoccupied with the remembrance of Allah. We remind ourselves of the blessings of Allah upon us. We remind ourselves how all of those difficulties, ultimately, if we see them in the right way and respond them in the right way, it will bring us close to Allah. Because of all of the people who are close to Allah, the closer you are, the more tried you are, the more difficulties that you have in life. And that's the amazing thing. We have a totally different perspective on tribulation. But that will open up the doors for us to have that internal strength and to struggle with it, knowing that there's not only light at the end of the tunnel, there's light in the tunnel. And in the midst of an incredibly difficult tribulation, there will be divine facilitation from Allah. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala teaches us, فَإِنَّ مَعْ عُسْرِ يُسْرَى, that indeed with hardship comes ease. But look at what Allah says. Not only for every difficulty is there two eases. إِنَّ مَعْ عُسْرِ يُسْرَى. Allah repeats it. But in the very moment of difficulty, there is ease. إِنَّ مَعْ عُسْرِ يُسْرَى. With difficulty, there is ease. In the very moment, if Allah is with you. And you are with Allah by remembering Him, and you love Him, and you see everything as being from Him. What a beautiful deen that we have. May Allah Ta'ala give us tawfiq to come together and to help one another, and to bless us all with a growth mindset, and to overcome the challenges in our time of trying to live this deen, and establish a seminary, and teach people their religion, and live together as a community. And to have relationships and thrive despite the difficulty of all these things, just holding on to our deen, the difficulties of being and being a part of a community, and the difficulties that come with doing this type of work, and all of the different forces at hand, outwardly and inner, they're trying to stop this and are going to be very happy if you and I give up. But that's not an option. May Allah give us fortitude and strength to persevere and to do what is right. And inshallah, most importantly, do what is pleasing to Allah and to the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And may we see the fruits of this work in our lifetimes and after. But may we do it because it needs to be done and solely for the sake of Allah ta'ala, detached from its results with the highest degree of sincerity, inshallah ta'ala. And that may it be we do this in a way, as they say, ala al-wasf al-mahbubiya, that we become beloved to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, and to his beloved Prophet and the Prophets and Messengers, the elect of his creation. Wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam Muhammadan wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
Thank you for watching one of Al-Maqasid's online educational offerings. Our mission at Al-Maqasid is to cultivate holistic learning environments rooted in knowledge, devotion, and service. For more information, please visit our website at almaqasid.org and connect with other online content at almaqasid.org/connect.